Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. I'm Paulo Sotero, director of the Brazil Institute here at the Wilson Center. I'm here to welcome you. Very glad you came this morning. I wanted to take this opportunity also to introduce two new members of our team, Natalie Kozlov, who is the new assistant to the program, and Camila Veloso, the new intern to the program. We are rebuilding our team after the departure of our Michael Darden, who is now pursuing his graduate studies at Duke, and Ana Carolina Cardenas, who is also going back to school soon, I assure you, because I am on her case, and she is working at a different outfit in town. But it's a great pleasure to have Ambassador Sergio Amaral with us this morning. Sergio is a dear personal friend, and we have actually an advisor on many things that we have done at the Wilson Center. He was here some time back in one of his previous capacities as president of the Brazil-China Business Council. But with that, my role is simply to introduce our chairman of the Brazil Institute, Ambassador Anthony Harrington, former U.S. ambassador to Brazil, who will introduce Ambassador Sergio Amaral. Thank you, Tony.
Thank you, Paulo. Good morning, everyone. It is quite an honor and a pleasure to welcome Ambassador Sergio Amaral back to Washington and to the Wilson Center. I believe this is the third time you've been posted to Washington, if I have it right. Among other things, the ambassador was deputy chief of mission in the 1990s under Ambassador Rubens Recupero. This will be his first public address as ambassador to the U.S., and we're quite gratified that he accepted the invitation to the Wilson Center to be with us today. I've been an admirer of Sergio Amaral since I had the privilege to represent our country in Brazil. A career diplomat, he's served his country with distinction at home and abroad, having been ambassador to both France and to the UK. In Brazil, he was President Fernando Henrique Cardoso's press secretary and spokesman, and then Minister of Development, Industry, and Commerce. Previously, he was Deputy Minister of Environment. The ambassador's roles have been so full and diverse that he probably falls into that proverbial category of the Renaissance man. Mm-hmm. Itamaraty, the Brazilian Foreign Service generally, is a particularly talented group of people, as I discovered in my own work there and since. And Sergio, some of your colleagues have heard me urge more than one Brazilian congressional delegation to guard against diminishing the national asset that the Brazilian Foreign Service represents. since his service in government, the ambassador could hardly be said to have retired, even if he retired from government. He's been active in business associations and international boards of important companies like Total, as well as environmental organizations. As Paulo mentioned, he's been president of the Brazil-China Business Council and was here in that capacity a few years ago. As we know, this has been a time of political, economic, and institutional challenge in Brazil, including a corruption scandal on a rather extraordinary scale. At the same time, I think we should applaud the determination of the country's judicial, prosecutorial, and law enforcement institutions, which are demonstrating the will and the capacity to pursue the matters where they lead and hold accountable those responsible, not to mention the role of the press and the public in asking for accountability as well. I'm optimistic that Brazil will come out of this moment of crisis stronger and hopefully provide a model that other nations can look to in facing similar issues. Today, the ambassador is here to share with us his perspective on Brazil-U.S. relations in a pivotal time for both our countries. Last week, at the reception he hosted in honor of Brazil's Independence Day, he said it is time to turn the page in our bilateral relationship toward a more results-oriented dialogue, consistent with the charge of our friend and new Foreign Minister José Serra. I believe this message will be very well received in Washington, Ambassador. We've sort of had a running period of a lot of talk, but not quite enough action. And despite all the things that demand our attention, it's time for dialogue and more results in our important bilateral relationship. And I believe that Sergio Amaral is the right person for this role and this time. Ambassador, the floor is yours. Welcome.
Good morning. I'm very pleased to be here again. I recognize some of you old friends in the audience, and I'm very happy to see you all. I thank Paulo Sotero and Ambassador Harrington for this invitation. I'm very pleased to be here. This is my first public address, and I think you should be here. Because Wilson Center has become a center stage for a plural and very well-informed discussion on Brazil. And I think Wilson Center plays a very important role in a debate which is of utmost importance for us, a debate of ideas, a debate of Brazilian policies. I thank you very much, Ambassador, for your very kind words. And I thank you for the work you have been accomplished here, as well as in your private practice, where you help very much US companies to go to Brazil. I had decided to leave the impeachment question to the second part of this meeting. But I can't resist emphasizing only two or three points. And I am, of course, prepared to discuss the matter further if you so wish. I think there are two basic issues to take into account when we discuss this very important, although painful, process which took place recently in Brazil. First is the nature of impeachment. Impeachment is not a legal question alone. It's a legal and political. Because if it were only legal, the place for the judgment would not have been the Senate, but the judiciary, the Supreme Court. Second, there are clear legal grounds for the impeachment. And these legal grounds lie in two issues. One, it's authorization of credit without the previous approval by the Congress. And the second is the fact that the financing was provided by public banks. So public banks financed the central government. And this is forbidden by the law of fiscal responsibility. And the third point is procedure. The procedure for an impeachment process is described in the Constitution in a very detailed way, two votes, by two-thirds of the House and of the Senate, in a long discussion, public discussion, most of which was broadcast online by television. And these procedures were strictly followed because they were under the supervision of the Supreme Court. And it was the Supreme Court president who presided over the session in the Senate. I think that instead of being a coup, I would rather prefer to see it as a lesson of democracy. Because of the involvement of society, because of the public debate, because the fact that the three branches of government followed, scrutinized the process of impeachment in a very detailed way. And they continued to perform their duties normally. Press provided a free coverage of the impeachment, and the military performed their duties. There were no declarations, no injuries. And that's why I don't feel very comfortable when people talk about a coup, because this is not true. I think what's most important for us now is the fact that impeachment opened up a new chapter in Brazilian recent history. First of all, the country is normalizing. After a period of confrontation, radical debate, of radicalization, we have now tranquility. We have a process of negotiation. Negotiation with Brazilian society, negotiation with the political parties, negotiation with unions, and mainly negotiations with Congress. And I would say this is the specialty of President Temer. He was president of the House for three times, and he knows how to negotiate with Congress, something which President Dilma found it very difficult to do. This is a very important asset for Brazil now, because we are going to face important reforms, and some of them constitutional reforms, which will require three-fifths of the vote in both houses of Congress, the House of Representatives and the Senate. On the political scene, the impeachment was a game changer. First of all, it continued some changes which already existed or which have been recently approved, as for instance, the prohibition of private financing of electoral campaigns. But what's more important is the new configuration of the party system and the emergence of PMDB as the main political party. The PMDB is in government. The main leaders in Congress, House and Senate, are from PMDB. And PMDB has proposed a program, for the post-impeachment period, which the other parties didn't do. Of course, PMDB has the bonus and the onus of being the main party. Because the bonus, because it will make, it will promote, it will lead change, but it will have to face the political difficulties and challenges of some very difficult reforms as social security. The second aspect is that the polarization between PSDB and PT, which prevailed in recent decades, has given place to the emergence of PMDB. And both parties, PT and PSDB, face some challenges, an important challenge in the case of PT, of the Workers' Party. It was defeated in the impeachment process, and some of important leaders from PT are in jail, as for instance the former chief of staff of the president. There is internal division, and there is no clear leadership besides Lula. Half of the candidates for the municipal election of the PT candidates are not going to present. So the number of people which are participating in the municipal elections is half of what used to be in the past. The PT has chosen or has decided in its recent meeting a strategy, and this is a strategy for 2018, which implies three main points. The first one is the victimization of former President Lula because of the so-called coup. The second is social mobilization. It's interesting to note that during the impeachment process, there was already a crew, a film crew, filming the events in order to show to the population and to provide for a mobilization of social movements. And the third point is that the attempt to restore the support of the basis, the traditional basis of PT in the electoral system, that's to say lower income people. PSDB has, as it has always had, qualified leaders. It supports the government, but it has no program, or it has not presented a real program, a comprehensive program. It has no connection with common people. I think I always remember something that Monica de Bol said some years ago. I don't know if you remember that. I liked very much the article. It was a research or a poll by IBGE, a research on the different sectors of society and how they benefited from the growth of the country. And this research by PNAD shows that the brackets between 2 and 5 minimum wages, the families, had improved the earnings by 50%, while the national average was 30%. What does that mean in electoral terms? This bracket represents 70% of the Brazilian population. And this shows why the Workers' Party was, this was one of the reasons why the Workers' Party was very successful in the previous elections. Now, the PSDB doesn't have this connection, this concrete connections with the low-income people. PT Lula talks the language of the poor people. He has an agenda for the poor people, and he has governed to the poor people. PSDB doesn't have this capacity because it was born in government, and it doesn't have a social basis as the Workers' Party had. And this is perhaps the major challenge for PSDB. And the real question is, will PSDB benefit from the participation in government, or the important beneficiary will be the PMDB? Now let's talk to the post-impeachment period with respect to the economy. There's a new direction for the economy, and it's very clear. And Meirelles, the Minister of Finance, has pointed out in one of his first presentations, one single point. My main task is to restore confidence in the business community. And to restore confidence, I will need to promote a fiscal reform, because the fiscal reform is the reason, the basic reason why, or the fiscal situation is the basic reason why we have high interest rates and we don't have investment. So, fiscal reform is the priority, and it is compounded by two main aspects. One of them is a reduction in expenditures, which already started, and a very ambitious proposal of having a freeze on expenditures of the government in real terms. Let's say in real terms, and supposedly this would last for 20 years, there will be no real increase in expenditures by the government. But together with the cut in expenditures, we'll have reforms. And some of these reforms have already been signalized have already been indicated by many members of the government. First of all, fiscal reform. What will it really be? We don't know exactly the details, but one of the main aspects and a difficult task is to have a unification of ICMS, which is a state tax, which is a very difficult thing. Second point of fiscal reform is Social Security. Social Security is responsible for a $60 billion in next year's budget. It's huge, and it has to be reformed. And probably the aspects of these reforms will be a minimum age increase and an indexation and the change in the indexation of Social Security expenditures. But labor is also important reform, and some features of the possible reform have already been indicated, which is the acceptance of collective agreements together with legal rules. This will open a very important alternative for the negotiation between the social partners, employees, and employers. Important aspect of the economic reforms, which is already underway, and nobody's paying much attention on that, is the restructuring of state companies. And the case of Petrobras is a very clear example, and the new president has been working hard in very little time to change the profile of the company. First of all, he has got a commitment for the president that there will be no political appointments for the board or for the executive board of Petrobras. A serious fiscal constraint, asset sales, renegotiation of the debt, and two important changes. One is the elimination of the mandatory participation of Petrobras, 30% participation in all projects in the oil sector. And second, no less important, is the elimination, or at least the reduction, on local content for equipments to be provided with built to Petrobras. Of course, these changes open up new and very important opportunities for foreign investors in Brazil. The second area in which we're going to have very important opportunities is infrastructure. Minister Moreira Franco is working hard. I had two discussions with him. I was very much impressed. He is preparing a new legal framework for tenders in the area of infrastructure. He'll provide longer periods of time, longer deadlines for companies to participate and understand the nature of the project, and perhaps working together with the government for the definition of such new regulations. A very competitive bidding with the participation of CADE, which is this authority for competition. Stimulate medium-sized companies to participate, and for that purpose to reduce the upfront capital which a company which participates has to bring. Upfront environment licensing. This is a revolution, because people who have participated in tenders in Brazil know that you can gain a contract, but it's very difficult to implement because there's a very complex and bureaucratic process, including in the area of the environment, and more comprehensive projects. Paulo and Ambassador Harrington mentioned the time I was president of the China-Brazil Business Council. And I used to feel very uneasy, because some of the Brazilian delegations abroad, the so-called road shows, presented the same projects for years. I attended most of them. It was a shame, because always it was announced that in the next few months the project would go to tender, and it never went. And whenever people asked for some details of the project, so what is the feasibility study, what is the rate of return of the projects, nobody could answer. We just have the names of the projects and a few general ideas. This will change. And Minister Moreira said that he doesn't want to come abroad with such a mission to present projects which are not further developed. And there's a large portfolio of possible projects for the participation of foreign investment. Airports in Salvador, Fortaleza, Porto Alegre, Florianópolis. Highways, railways, which are extremely important. It's a good opportunity for investment because it will substantially reduce the cost of producing in Brazil. People who take soybeans from the countryside, from the center west to the port, paying in transportation the same amount of costs for the production of soybeans. There's no way we can be competitive with such obstacles. Hydroelectric plants, oil and gas, ports. These are only a few areas in which will be opened for foreign participation. In the social area, what is the post-impeachment scenario? There is strong concern by the president in securing employment, in reducing the rate of unemployed people, which reaches now almost 11% of the workforce. And at the same time, to preserve the social programs. And he said, if the social programs under Lula and Dilma were good, why not to keep them and to improve them and perhaps to provide more efficiency to the projects? Lava Jato, the so famous Lava Jato, which is an unprecedented investigation of corruption in Brazil, will continue. And there's no alternative, because public opinion would not allow any change, any interference in Lava Jato, because it's a very legitimate action by the federal police. But at the same time, Lava Jato is an unguided missile, because nobody knows what will be the next action, who this action will affect them, and the possible impact, not only on companies, but also on the political arena, on political leaders. Now, let's talk a little bit about foreign policy. My intention was not to give here today a comprehensive idea of possible changes in foreign policy. The main guidelines are in the inaugural speech by Minister Serra, who set up how he calls it a decalogue of 10 main basic guidelines for foreign policy. But the main principle of foreign policy have been clearly stated by Minister Serra and for the president himself. Foreign policy has to reflect the values and interests of the Brazilian society rather than the ideological preference of a single party. And this is by itself a sea change in foreign policy. And I'll just mention two aspects of the new foreign policy. One is Mercosul. We have in Mercosul a unique opportunity because for the first time in many years, there's a convergence between Brazil and Argentina. We used to go in opposite directions. When Argentina would go towards opening up at the markets, we were closing. And when we opened up the markets, they closed. For the first time, we seemed to go in the same direction. And this opens a new possibility for Mercosul, for the renovation of the Mercosul, for the elimination of restrictions in Mercosul, and perhaps to have new trade agreements. Because during the period which started in 2002, Brazil had only three trade agreements with Israel, with the Gulf countries, and the third I don't even remember.
Egypt.
So I think that's not much at the time when most countries really entered into serious and comprehensive trade negotiations. We are lagging behind. The irony of history is that at the time we decided to open up our economy, apparently the major blocs, Europe and the United States, ran the risk of closing more to trade. And I'll mention relations between Brazil and the United States. There also, I think we have a unique opportunity for cooperation. And more than items of cooperation, the unique opportunity we have is to overcome the ups and downs in our relations which prevailed during the second half of the 20th century. Sometimes we were closer, sometimes we were more distant. And I think we may be reaching, I hope, a time of maturity in which we would decide the actions we'll have on the basis of the merits of the projects, of the proposals, of our coincidence, and not as preconceived approaches. And we have many areas we share, many areas of convergence. We have democracy, in which Brazil will probably have a more active participation. Human rights, which is a pet subject for Minister Serra. Environment, and I am very committed to that. As Ambassador Harrington mentioned, I am in the board of WWF Brazil. This is an area I really would like to work with our U.S. partners and trade. And we have agreed upon a considerable number of projects, creation of working groups, commissions. Some of them haven't even started. So there is, on both sides, a joint effort to accelerate these projects and to go ahead. But the basic principle is, wherever we converge, there's no reason not to work together. And wherever we don't have a coincidence, there's no reason why we can't say that in very clear terms. These projects, which are around 50 projects, mixed commissions, working groups, are concentrated in a few very important sectors. One of them is, of course, the economy. Our agenda in the area of energy is huge, it's widespread. It includes almost all areas of energy and basically alternative energies. We have trade, in which at least we can do more trade facilitation. It includes infrastructure. And infrastructure is, as I mentioned before, an area in which we would welcome U.S. investments. But I think they should also hurry up, because the possibility the government is opening is not only to participate in pre-established projects, is to work together in the definition and in preparation of projects, because the guideline by Minister Moreira Franco is, let's work together and let's accommodate to the extent possible the wishes of potential investors. And I think this is very important. And I think it's the time for new missions to Brazil in this area to fund the preparation of projects. We have many aircraft partnerships, and this is a big success, and this is a very important development. Boeing and Embraer are working together in promoting the new CK390 Embraer transportation aircraft. And this is a sea change in our cooperation with American companies. Defense is another area I was very much surprised. It has a big number of projects, very important programs. It's not only the exchange of military cooperation. It's the partnership between the defense industry in Brazil and the defense industry in the United States. It includes also this portfolio projects, many areas of interest for society, like education, like culture. And it includes also the area of the academy, joint research and health. Finally, I would like to mention something you know quite well, which is my perception. I don't know whether it's right or wrong, that we are underrepresented in Washington. Not only in financial agencies, the Bretton Woods institutions and the IDB, where our participation is limited. Perhaps it's our fault. We never paid attention to that. We are big, large, inward country. We are turned inwards. Up until a certain time, the world globalization did not exist. We found out that the external world existed some 10 or 15 years ago. But we are also underrepresented, I think, that in the think tanks in Washington. We are underrepresented in a very important dialogue that takes place in this fora, and which we would like to be more active. And this is one of the priorities of the embassy, in order to bring our views and to participate in debate. Summing up, the new government has a vision of the country we want to build. This vision is democracy, is human rights, is environment, and above all, reducing inequality in our society. There are clear guidelines, and I try to show some of them to you. There is a roadmap. The government has a majority in Congress, and above all, the president is a skillful negotiator who has been president of the House 3 times, knows how to deal in Congress. And this will be extremely important to us and to implement the reform. This does not mean the task will be easy. Some of the policies may be easier. Some of the policies the president wants to implement are an uphill battle, and we are determined to face it. I would like to end with a quote by an Argentinian economist who is a good friend, whom I liked very much, and many of you know him. It's Dante Sic. Talking about the new Macri government, he said, "This government will have to be politically viable, economically consistent, and socially tolerable." I think this quote applies to Brazil also. Thank you very much.
Well, I assume you have questions for the ambassador, and please identify yourselves and should just wait for the microphone. Camila, right here. Oh. No, right here first. Ambassador.
Thank you very much. Hattie Babbitt with the World Resources Institute. And I have a question on the environmental front. Brazil has made some important commitments and has important global responsibilities with respect to climate change and the Paris Agreement. And I wonder how the new government is planning to respond to that.
The new government is 1 month old. So I don't think the new government has been able up until now to set its priorities in most of the issues in detail. There is an overall commitment which is not necessarily or totally new, because we accepted some commitments in the area of the preservation of forest. I know that in some multilateral fora, Brazil as well as other countries have showed some reserve in taking up commitments which were not perceived as balanced. I think you will find a new Brazil more flexible to accept commitments and I would like to mention in this respect the approach by Ambassador Hikupuru, who was ambassador in Washington, was minister for the environment, and said Brazil should not be seen in the area of environment or to behave in the area of environment in a defensive way. On the contrary, we have to take leadership of the discussion of the environment because we have very important assets. It's one of the largest areas on biodiversity in the world. It's one of the largest forests. And we have to correspond to such assets and to have a leadership role in the world. I think we are going in this direction. I am not able to give you details for the time being.
Well, just before we move to the next question, just since Ambassador Babbitt has a connection with the World Resources Institute, just to let you know, mark your calendars, October the 28th, we are going to present here with the Institute a new study on the restoration of degraded land in Latin America and the Caribbean. Brazil is a major part of that effort because Brazilian agriculture will expand, will continue to expand, but mostly by using degraded, recovery degraded land for expansion of agriculture. That's one of the reasons it's already happening. Brazil has last year increased 6.7% its yield in agriculture, agricultural productivity, with not much expansion of the area that is used for agriculture. So with that, next question was here in the back, and then we will move to Claudia there. Yes, please.
Thank you. I'm Joan Fauza, reporter of El País, a Spanish newspaper. I wanted to ask the ambassador if you had any comment on what happened yesterday, that Mr. Cunha lost his seat as a legislator in Brazil, and if he believe this could have an impact on the political situation in Brazil. Thank you.
I couldn't hear the last part of your question. Cunha, I understood the last part.
Well, the impact of this latest development in the political situation in Brazil. Thank you.
I think it was a very important development because this corresponds to the normal functioning of the judiciary first, which recognized some of the indictments of the former president of the House, and it's a normal functioning of the House, which decided by a big majority vote that there were grounds for Cunha to lose its mandate. I don't know where there will be many a very important impact on PMDB and on the party system, because this was more or less an expected development. And from the point of view of the perception of Brazil and of the impeachment process, the impact is certainly positive, because one of the criticisms which was frequent with respect to impeachment, how can a president be impeached when some people who are denounced, who are indicted for corruption, have leading positions in Congress? And Congress gave a response for that.
Okay, again, on just to add some information, Mr. Cunha, by the fact that he was expelled from Congress by more than 500, the vote of more than 500, more than 400 of his peers, has lost what we call in Brazil the privileged forum from injustice. So he will be, his case, which involves allegations of corruption, will be tried in Curitiba by Judge Sergio Moro, that many of you may have had a chance to meet when he was here on July the 14th. I would like to add also questions related to the judicial process and fighting corruption will be one of the topics on November the 7th here, when we will have Minister Gilmar Mendes and Minister Teori Savaski in this room talking, addressing you on our series on the rule of law. Claudia Trevisan from Estado de São Paulo.
Hi, Ambassador. I have a question about Brazil and another about bilateral relations with the U.S. You said that Brazil has now tranquility, but it's not what we are seeing on the streets. Since President Temer took office, there are a lot of protests. How, and there is, it's clear that part of the population is not satisfied with the new government. So how the government will deal with that? And the other question related to the U.S., Minister Serra said that one of his priorities will be the question of non-tariff barriers. And that is something that is being on the agenda for on the bilateral relations for years and without any solution. How big it will be a priority for you in the U.S. and how optimistic you are about that? Thank you.
Thank you for a question. As to the last part, the first part of it, which is participation or reaction of the population in the impeachment process, I would say that impeachment had an overwhelming support of society when it was submitted to Congress. 83% of the people approved it. At the final stage, a majority of people approved it, not so large a majority as at the beginning. Now, with respect to the approval rate of President Temer, I think we need some more time to make a judgment because, as I mentioned to you, his government is 1 month old. And what you realize in Brazil now, and it's not in Brazil, but in many countries, is the fact that populations are very reluctant, very hesitant, and in some cases very hostile vis-a-vis governments. And this is a worldwide phenomenon. I think that President Cardoso wrote an article about that. I gave an interview to Estado de São Paulo some 2 months ago saying, which the headlines were, is there a limit or a decline of liberal democracy of representative democracy? I think this is a clear case in Europe because the party system was not able to identify at the beginning the difficulties and the hardships imposed by globalization. And the population turned to alternative parties or alternative movements, not to the parties. And I think the case of the present election in the United States is also an example of that, because people are very critical of the existing or part of the existing parties. I think the same thing applies to Brazil. People supported impeachment up until the end of the process. But the same support which existed for the impeachment does not exist for the Temer government. I think with time, with the results of which we can already have sense in the economy, for instance, we have the early signals that things are changing, that inflation may come down, that the growth rate will be more than expected, that unemployment is not increasing. Of course, this will bring about more support to the present government. But what I think, above all, what is important is that President Temer has already said he's not looking for re-elections. And he has some freedom and some autonomy of decisions because he's not looking for easy results, and what he is committed is to carry out the reforms he has already said that the economy needs to restore growth and, above all, to reduce unemployment.
On the other part of the question?
Tariff.
Oh, I see. That's true. The embassy has just finished a survey on some restrictions that exist for the export of Brazilian products to the U.S. This is a comprehensive study, and we are thinking about, we review it, and we are thinking about circulating this report in Brazil and in the U.S. together with some other news which are very important. People perhaps do not realize that investments, Brazilian investments, are already important. We have $22 billion of investment in the United States. These investments create jobs in the United States, and this gives us a very good argument for the importance of bilateral economic exchange. But of course, there are some difficulties. We will work on that. And the first step is to understand the kind of difficulties. It is true what Minister Serra says, that sometimes we talk about Brazil, very often a very protectionist country. This is not true. Perhaps our average tariff is higher than some other countries, 11-12%. U.S. is 4-5%. But we don't have non-tariff barriers. If we have, they are very restricted. And today, as you know, protectionism is a matter of licensing, not of tariffs. I remember we did a study, and I see André here, who was one of the authors of this study at the China-Brazil Business Council. And we'll talk about China. They are not protectionist in terms of tariff, but the licensing program is so opaque, is so complex, then in some areas you cannot export. And I think that we need to have a more deeper research on the kind of protectionism we have in Brazil. And I agree, recently protectionism increased, and I think these barriers will be removed. But we have to take into account not a competition who is more protectionist, but it is an effort to understand where protectionism lies and the ways we can resort to reduce it.
Thank you. Luis Fernando Silva Pinto from Global Television.
Bom dia, embaixador.
Bom dia, Fernando.
Will the diplomatic strategy for the visit of President Temer to New York at the opening of the United Nations General Assembly be different from the strategy in China for the G20, and if so, how?
I'm not very well aware of the strategy in China. I didn't get any clear report on that. I think that the participation of President Temer at the inaugural address of the UN Assembly will basically talk about a new Brazil. A new Brazil in the effort to restore the economy, in the effort to reinforce negotiation as the main tool of politics, not confrontation, negotiation. That's what is happening in Brazil. The full respect for democracy, human rights, and abroad, perhaps to point out that there is a new foreign policy. But if you could tell me what was the strategy in China, perhaps I could be more explicit, but I was not informed about that.
Apparently, the strategy in China was an international presentation of the new government, in New York, there will be probably the opportunity for meetings with leaders like President Obama, President Putin, and I was wondering if that would entail a specific strategic push for...
Okay. I think that it will be a wider opportunity for showing, let's say, the new Brazil. It changes domestically, it changes abroad, and to have a discussion on many, many issues of interest. But besides with the discussion during the General Assembly and in parallel with the General Assembly, President Temer will have a larger meeting focused but not exclusive to the business community. There will be a luncheon at the American Society, and this luncheon will be preceded by a more private meeting with a group of CEOs of U.S. companies. This will be an opportunity for President Temer, who will be together with Meirelles, with Serra, and possibly other ministers, to talk about Brazil, to talk about what the government is doing, and at the same time to listen about the perceptions of influential people in the U.S. about Brazil, what they think, what they suggest, because we want to attract investments, and if is there any changes we can introduce to our regulatory system which will further attract foreign investment in Brazil, I think Minister Moreira Franco, who will participate in this meeting, will be very open to that, provided this is compatible with the Brazilian legislation. But the problem is not the Brazilian legislation. In some cases, was the regulatory framework which was applied to foreign investment. I don't know whether I answered to your question.
Well, a question in the back here.
Please. Aaron Rosen from the Bank of Tokyo Mitsubishi. Mr. Ambassador, thank you for your address as well as for answering our questions. I will actually be heading to Brazil in a few days, so this is very timely.
Again, I can't listen to you well.
Sure. I'll be heading to Brazil in a few days, so this is very timely. My question is, in particular, you touched on the themes of democracy, human rights, as well as Mercosur. So naturally, that leads me to the question of Venezuela.
Yeah.
I was wondering how this government might have a... change in its relationship with Venezuela, both in the context of Mercosur, as well as in the context of the internal human rights and democratic catastrophe that we're seeing in Venezuela. Thank you.
Thank you for your question. I think it's very timely. One of the first actions by Foreign Minister Serra when he took office in Itamaraty was a quite clear note on the issue of human rights. And instead of a contemporization of the past, he said very clearly, human rights are a priority for the Brazilian government, and the Brazilian government criticizes any violation of human rights. That being said, there is no intention from the Brazilian government in any kind of intervention on domestic affairs of Venezuela, on the domestic conflict in Venezuela. The solution for such problems lies in the hands of the Venezuelan people alone. What Brazil said is, is there any means in which you can help in such a discussion, in finding out a solution for the problem, we are at your disposal. And we also are at your disposal to send, to provide for humanitarian aid. We mentioned specifically medicines, but our offer was not accepted by Venezuela.
Henrique Gomes Batista from O Globo newspaper.
Oh, within the
That you are right. Within the context of Mercosur, it's a legal position. I don't know why. The accession of Venezuela to Mercosur was made the other way round. For many international organizations, people who want to accede, they negotiate the conditions first, then they are accepted. There are some countries who took 10 years of discussions with the European Union to be accepted. In the case of Venezuela, it was the other way around. We first accepted the accession of Venezuela, then we discussed the conditions. The result is that after 4 years, Venezuela did not comply with the engagement, and crucial engagements, because they had to do with the incorporation of the external common tariff, the TEC, the incorporation of the common tariffs in Venezuela, or the acceptance of the diplomatic clause. The deadline expired on August 12th. And what Brazil said, Venezuela doesn't have the legal grounds to be president, even a temporary president or presidents of Mercosur.
Mr. Ambassador, if you allow me, just a reminder, when Venezuela was accepted as a member of Mercosur, former Foreign Minister Celso Laffer wrote a piece in Folha de São Paulo saying that that decision was based on illegal grounds. He's a doctor of law. He's an internationalist. He was Foreign Minister of Brazil and ambassador. So you have the origin of the complication. Henrique Gomes Batista from Jornal O Globo.
Mr. Ambassador, how the relationship between Brazil and United States can change if Donald Trump was elected?
Sorry, I couldn't hear you.
How the relationship between Brazil and United States can change if Donald Trump wins the election?
Oh, that's a good question. I'd like to ask you and the American people. You know, I would not, as ambassador, give an opinion which is exclusively a domestic affair, domestic will of the American people. What I can tell you is a marginal comment, which is the nature of the electoral debate may have a lasting influence in spite of who is elected. Because you may have realized that the issues of trade came to the forefront of discussions. And I fear that whoever is elected will be induced or forced to take some measures in the area of trade which do not correspond to a free trade traditional commitment by the United States.
Okay, John Lopez from Lockheed Martin here in the front, please.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. John Lopez, Lockheed Martin. The question I have is in reference to the corruption. We now have Mensalão, Lava Jato, and in its 25th stage in the pension fund scandal. Clearly, we're beyond a case to a movement, possibly a cultural movement. So my question is two parts. What should we see, what should we be looking for that Brazil is doing to make this cultural movement last, this make it a permanent change as a part of society? And then part two to that question is in the Brazilian FCPA law, the Clean Companies Act, there are provisions in there that encourage foreign companies to take actions that would influence discussions and extensions of our compliance programs in Brazil. So in regards to that, what should the U.S. and by its nature U.S. companies be doing to assist in that transformation?
It's a very good question. I'll come with the last, I'll start with the last part of it. I don't know, perhaps they exist, but I don't know any action by U.S. companies to reinforce their compliance regulations or to go beyond what they do. I don't expect Brazilian companies or Brazilian government to request for that. With respect to Lava Jato, the extension is totally unprecedented. We have almost 30 important business leaders who are indicted, in custody, or convicted and are in jail. We have a similar number of politicians who have been accused, who have been mentioned in some of the plea bargains that existed. And we have a very important number of companies themselves involved. 18 companies participated in the cartel of involved with Petrobras. So it's a very widespread corruption epidemic. And the question that remains is, how can we assure a real change in society? You may remember that in 1991, President Collor was impeached for corruption. And apparently, this was not enough. This is a question that the attorneys have been discussing, and the prosecutors presented to Congress a 10-point list for regulation or for new policies against corruption. You may remember that the same concern happened in Italy with the Mani Pulite, which is a source of inspiration for Lava Jato. And this 10-point list is being discussed. It is being discussed also in Congress. I don't know exactly what are the measures that will take place. I think this is still an open question, but certainly there is a very important commitment of society to give continuity to this effort of Lava Jato, and so that this is not a one-shot operation, and the fight for against corruption may continue. What I can tell you is that there are not many examples I know, except for Mani Pulite in Italy, of a so fierce attack on corruption as we have had in Brazil, with strong support in society and with full coverage of the press. I hope this provides us a lesson for the future.
Thank you, Marcelo Nino from Folha de São Paulo.
Bom dia, embaixador.
Bom dia.
Regardless the result of the elections here in the U.S., in your result-oriented strategy, what results do you think can be achieved in the time frame of, let's say, the 2 years and a little bit in 2 years and a half of President Temer government?
With respect to our bilateral relations, I'm very confident. I am very confident because there were on both sides important moves in favor of an enduring U.S.-Brazil relationship. On the U.S. side, the policies taken by President Obama vis-a-vis Latin America, his commitment to a multilateral approach, to negotiation, instead of pressures and the interventions of the past, are a very good signal. And Cuba is a very important point in case. The normalization of relations with Cuba was a positive signal for Latin American countries, which allows for unimpeded relations between the two sides. In the case of Brazil, there was an equally important movement, and this is a longer story which would require more time, because if you take the relations with the United States have been a definition moment of our foreign policy. Our foreign policy used to be defined as pro or against the United States. The two figures of Brazilian diplomacy in the 20th century were Barão do Rio Branco and the Externa Política, Externa Independente, foreign policy, independent foreign policy of Santiago Dantas. And these two references alternated in Brazilian foreign policy and perhaps contaminated it. Now, there's no reason for that. These were reminiscences or vestiges of the Cold War. The Cold War is over. There is no reason by which we should face the United States as a prejudgment or a pre-evaluation. Oh, the United States is good, we are going to be together. The United States is not good, we are not going to be together. I think we are approaching an age, or age is perhaps too pretentious a time, for maturity in our relations, in which we'll discuss what we are going to do according to the merit of the point of the agenda. If the proposal is good, why not to discuss? Why not to work together? If there's no coincidence, why not to say? President Sarkozy, when he first came to Washington, and you remember that France had a kind of preconceived approach, at least that's the comes from De Gaulle, vis-a-vis France, he said, the friendship among countries includes the possibility to disagree. And that's what we must have to learn. Not to have a preconceived approach, oh, this government is pro-United States or it's against the United States. We're not against or pro any country. But there are countries in which you have more convergences, and you have many important convergences with the United States, as I mentioned. Democracy, human rights, environment, trade. There are other areas we do not converge. That's why I think we have to revisit this important list of projects, of working groups and so on, to see which are our priorities on both sides and how we can accelerate projects which we think are beneficial for both countries. So that's why I am confident that whoever is elected in the United States, we have a new atmosphere in U.S.-Brazilian relations, and we have take benefit from this positive atmosphere. Because you think this question is crucial for the definition of U.S.-Brazilian relations. There's a former U.S. ambassador, perhaps you met him, Danilovich, whom I met when I arrived back to São Paulo in 2005. We had lunch, and he said something very simple, but very important. I asked him, how are relations between the two countries? He said, relations are good, but we can't connect. And the problem, and I remember also many institutions, the CEO Forum, SABRI, Sebeu, who made a series of studies with propositions of a positive agenda. The problem is not in the agenda. The problem is confidence. If we trust each other, things will go ahead. If we don't trust each other, things won't go ahead. And I think that to reach the point in which exists confidence is there, and you have to select the projects which you like to develop.
Thank you. Juliano Basile from Valor Econômico.
Hi, Ambassador. It's nice to see you here. You mentioned Michel Temer's ability to approve things in Congress. He was the House Speaker for two or three times in Brazil. How fast do you think that the government is going to be able to approve the economic reforms in order to get the credibility in the international markets?
That's a key question. Coming back to President Temer's ability sometime, reading the papers, I think I would like to be hidden in one of President Temer's discussions with representatives, to attend it, not be seen, to understand what does he say to them. Because they come to the meeting with very tough declarations. They go out of the meeting, smile, happy, and they vote for him. What does he say to them? But this is not a question of miracle. It is a question of balance. And that's why I quoted Dante Sica. I think the government is in the right direction. But he deserves a credit and perhaps time. Because all these changes on the political side, on the economy, on social programs, have to go together. We cannot expect to prioritize one sector at the cost of the other, because things will not work. Something that I learned during the time of Cardoso and was responsible for the communication of the government is that change you have to explain to people. If you don't explain, they don't understand. And finally, and moreover, if they don't understand what they gain with change, they won't accept, and you cannot impose. And that's the secret for the Cardoso administration. That's why he was able to make some very difficult changes. He opened up the economy for foreign investment. He privatized Vale do Rio Doce, which was an icon. Why? Because there was explanation. He explained very well. We organized advertising campaigns. I was responsible for that, to explain some of the reforms. This may take some time, but it is better to take some time and to have a more solid change than to be very in a lot of market anxiety and try to comply with the markets if we don't have the real support for change. I can't give you a timetable, but what I can say you that politicians now have closed the chapter of impeachment, and they are already looking for 2018. All parties know, more than others, PMDB knows. It has for the first time a chance. But this chance will depend on the capacity of the government to implement reforms to restore growth and employment. So this will be a main concern. I would say it is for PSDB, it is for PMDB, it is for the parties in the for the alliance. But it's difficult to assess now what will be the largest difficulties. We know which are the reforms which will be more difficult. But would unions understand that some of the reforms are in their benefit too? This will depend on negotiation. And I think that if you're not able to convince people, it will be difficult to make reforms.
Thank you very much. Peter Hakim, Inter-American Dialogue.
Thank you very much. Welcome back to Washington, Sergio.
Hello, Peter.
I think that most of us here sort of believe that the most important priority is economic recovery at this stage, that much of what else you want to do depends on that recovery, that that has to be the most important job. And I presume it's the most important job you have as well, is sort of on getting the economic relationship with the U.S. right. Because the U.S. really is, most of all, a market, a source of investment and all. My conversations with the U.S. government gives me a sense that there's not any good ideas circulating now in Washington
about what the government could do to help Brazil, to assist Brazil, to work with Brazil right now to sort of move forward. And I'm just wondering if you're coming now with any very concrete ideas. If we begin with commissions and working groups, that's all very good, but that takes time, and time passes, and governments pass. The question is there any two or three priorities that you're bringing to Washington right now?
That's a very good question, and I don't know whether I have an answer, because I think there is no magic proposal for that. My main concern is that we share important items of the international agenda, and we should work better in these areas. The second point, I agree with you, whoever has 50 priorities has none, and we should select among these 50, around 50 different issues, select our priorities for both sides. The projects, and they are very important projects, which can be completed, solved in the short run, because they will have a demonstration effect on other ones. And put aside projects, groups, which we think were not going to bring results in the reasonable time, so that we can have results shortly. And perhaps we may need a system for evaluation. Because it's not enough to create committees or working groups. We have to give these working groups a very clear mandate, a very clear purpose to assess this periodically and to set up timetables for results. This may look like very modest goals, but they are not, because there is much we can do together, and we should work to make them happen. Now, there is a very important component, if you wish a priority, which is the mobilization of the private sector. You have a CEO forum, you have many business groups, centers. I'm not convinced that they converge. I had a meeting with the AMSHAN in São Paulo, had a meeting with the CEO Forum. I had been talking to many different companies. And there is enormous duplication. Wouldn't that be possible to make some kind of convergence among these groups? Because all these groups are putting proposals every day. But there has to be a priority also, because the government receives mixed ideas, mixed suggestions. And it's a very comfortable situation for the government, because he receives so many suggestions that he says, I don't have an idea, a concrete idea of what you want. So I think that the private sector has a role to play. And in case U.S. companies start investing in Brazil again, it would be very important. Because what's the problem we have with trade? There's no problem. The U.S. has been having surpluses, successive surpluses with us, sometimes of around almost $10 billion. Now that the surplus decreased, it is $4 billion. Brazilian investments here are expanding. They are creating jobs here. We don't have a major issue among ourselves. What we have is to remove mistrust, which prevailed for some time, and work together with a clear idea of objectives, of results, and having a way to assess what's going on. I'll say you something which is not in detriment of the U.S.-Brazilian relations, but I followed the China-Brazil relations for 5 years. And I think that the Chinese perhaps have a better system of assessing results than we have among us. Because, as you know, almost everything in China is concentrated in the hands of government. And it's easy for the government to put 8 ministers together and say what is going on in each one of the areas and take the decision. This is not our system, fortunately. But I think we need some kind of follow-up and timetable for results. This would be my suggestion. It seems to be modest, but it make a big change.
Thank you. Monica DeBol from the Peterson Institute.
Thank you, Ambassador, and thank you very much for your very clear and cogent remarks on a number of very difficult issues. The question I have goes back a bit to your response to Giuliano's question, and I think you referred to something that is very much a concern, this issue of communication and how do you actually communicate the reform efforts that the government is trying to do. As you very well mentioned, under the Cardozo administration, there was evidently a very good communications
Thank
effort
you.
to get the message across. But it was a time during which one of the main reforms being implemented was a very positive reform when it comes to the effects on the middle class and the poor, and that was the reduction, the Real Plan, and the reduction of inflation. Currently, the reform agenda is very much focused on urgent and necessary measures, especially on the fiscal front. But these are measures that will have, although they have a confidence-boosting element to them, they're very necessary for medium-term sustainability, they do have an immediate negative impact on the population. So the question I have is, how is the government, how is the Temer administration going to actually send the message to people about what is the Social Security reform all about? Why is it needed? Why is it needed at this point in time? How is that going to bring benefits to people going forward? So I have my concern is, how do you actually get across the message that these things will be good, but you're not going to see them yet? You might only see them in the medium term.
Yeah, I agree with you that it is a difficult task. But if you pay attention to what President Temer has been saying, there is a recurrent word that is employment. And I think this is the main concern of the Brazilian people. And I think by means of setting up the relationship between reforms, recovery, and employment, this might be a way. But even though I think it's difficult, and I don't know how strong this argument would be perceived at a time when the unions may start to talk on very short-term issues. And I think they will, because this is part of Workers' Party strategy, it's mobilization. Mobilization, because if the Workers' Party don't mobilize their traditional partners, affiliates, they will be in a very difficult situation. And I think the local elections will show that PT is declining. So this is part of the game. Criticism on impeachment, the short-term objectives in the area of the economy, but there's no way. The only way out is try to explaining people, providing them with information, try to mobilize people, and I think that Congress is more prepared to understand the need for reform and some of its hardships at the moment when the Congress could no longer stand a situation in which the population was perplexed by the lack of direction of the economy and for the measures which were taking, which raised the real risk of a disaster.
Antonio Josino Meirelles from the Brazil Information Center. I think this would, any more? One more there, yes. Let me grab, get the two.
Bom dia, embaixador.
Bom dia, Antonio.
Welcome.
Thank you.
My question goes regarding the business agenda. As you said, that there is a duplication of forums, of private sector forums, and also many issues on the table, the U.S.-Brazil relationship. We at the Brazil Industries Coalition have mapped the presence of Brazilian private sector here, and it's amazing. We have at least 40 Brazilian affiliates operating in more than 150 districts, and we know that Brazilian affiliates, they generate more jobs, much more actually, the double of jobs than Indian or Chinese ones. There is, as you said, a strong basis for leveraging this relationship and developing some issues that are on the agenda. One issue that I think it's a common sense among all those forums is the double taxation agreement. Do you think in this new phase of the bilateral relation, is there a room for progressing with those discussions?
May I ask you a question?
Yes.
Do you think the business community agrees on what the double taxation agreement should be?
Yes, I think both sides have a lot to talk, but
this is perhaps the most difficult item of the agenda.
Yes.
And this is the most important claim of the big Brazilian companies that operate in the United States. But if you talk to the business community as a whole, there are many doubts and many differences. I think there's a sympathy of the government for a double taxation agreement. Before coming here, I visited a few ministers who have much at stake in our bilateral relations. I talked to Minister Meirelles, and he said he would discuss the matter with the Revenue Service. The point is that at the present moment, the fiscal situation is difficult, and I think it's not the right moment for the Federal Revenue Service to give up some collection of taxes. I think this is not for the short run, but I think that this should be a priority issue in the agenda. The other people remind me that the tax systems are very different, and the combination or reconciliation of different provisions would be difficult. But I think the main problem is tax collection, and both revenue services want to preserve the money they collect. This will require a high-level decision of the main ministers.
Okay, one more, yes.
Bem-vindo, embaixador. Lori Fussell. Trabalho no, I work at the Department of Federal Aviation Administration.
I can't hear you.
Hi, can you hear me now? I work at the Federal Aviation Administration and just wanted to thank you for your words in the aviation industry and infrastructure. I just had the opportunity actually to return from Rio for the Olympics. Parabéns. I have to say, honestly, the Washington, D.C. area would have shut down with the amount of people that got transported throughout Rio between the metro, between the buses, airports. Fantastic job. I'll be brief. I know you mentioned the infrastructure road shows. I'm familiar with the efforts that Brazil has done over the years. I'm familiar with the regional airport strategy, the optimistic goal of working on 270 airports. I recognize the government is coming on board to look at new priorities going forward, but if you could speak just briefly on some of the aviation projects that you guys are looking at, and talk a little bit about the regional airports and where that's going. I know that was in the news recently. Thank you.
I didn't understand the question.
If you could talk a little bit about where the regional airports
projects are going.
Yes. Thank you.
You know, I'm not an expert in these areas, but I know that many states are concentrated on regional airports. The state of São Paulo, for instance. There are many initiatives to expand the number of regional airports. And I think there is room for that because other states are also concerned about that. But I am not in a condition to give you some details on this.
Okay, thank you very much. You have one more? Brief one, please. Yes.
Yeah, just
since he's a journalist.
I wanted to do a follow-up on what you said. You said you were concerned that whoever is the next president of the U.S. could lose a bit the philosophy in favor of free trade and so on. So I wanted to ask you, are you particularly concerned?
Sorry, I can't follow you.
You were saying that you're concerned that whoever is the next president of the U.S., since the free trade conversation has gotten in front of the political agenda, you were saying you're concerned that the U.S. may lose a bit of its philosophy in favor of free trade. So I wanted to ask you, are you specifically concerned about this regarding Brazil, that a conversation between the U.S. and Brazil about free trade could get affected, but whoever is the next president, and this new conversation about free trade in the U.S.?
Okay. Where are you from?
Which from Spain, yeah.
Sorry?
Spain.
Spain.
El País.
El País. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, there's something which intrigues me. Why some leaders say things that we don't understand, or we don't understand why they say that. Why many European parties in Germany, Spain, and Italy are strongly against the European Union? Because there is a popular feeling against the European Union. And why some candidates in the United States talk about things that we really don't understand quite well? Because there are sectors of the US society that support this kind of visions. So what I try to convey to you is that the electoral debate in the United States, whoever is elected, will bring about some new ideas because they reflect what the electoral campaign was and what some sectors of the U.S. society feel. I don't know whether they have a clear proposal, but what they feel. And in this sense, what I feel also is that both in Europe and the United States, there is a growing feeling against globalization. Perhaps globalization went too far. Globalization didn't provide the right compensations for sectors of society which were affected. The party system did not identify such problems and did not represent such constituencies. In this sense, I think there is an irony of history. At the time when Brazil comes to the negotiating table for discussing trade, perhaps some of our main partners, both in Europe and the United States, are not prepared to do that. If you take the declarations, even by Angela Merkel recently, with respect to trade, they are worrisome. And in some respects, some people in the United States are saying similar things, even those who in the past supported the Trans-Pacific Partnership or the European Trade and Investment Partnership. I think U.S.-Europe Trade and Investment Partnership is stalled, and I have no idea when this will come back, if it will.
Okay, thank you. Last question, please be brief because we are 3 minutes away from closing.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Ida Scho, Society for Developmental Biology. And it seems to me that a question, one issue that is not always addressed by most of the governments, not only in Brazil, is education. Can you tell us something about Temer's plans for education?
I think you are right. Or many governments talk about education, but they don't do what should be done. Education is a very, very complex issue in Brazil. I followed up this more closely during the Cardoso administration. And I think that successive ministers were able to expand education to the majority of pupils, of students at school age. We have 95% of students, of pupils at between 8 and 14 we have at school. But the result is that, was that, now you have to fight for better quality education. I don't know if you take in mind the fact that the 88 constitution in Brazil has a provision which is a mandatory obligation of the state to provide free and universal services of health and education, something that not even the United States had in the area of health up until recently. So I think the system is quite disorganized. There was a proliferation of private universities, for instance. It was not always that we have a quality in higher education. This is a big priority for the government and for the Brazilian society. What's very interesting is that you have in many business circles companies which are investing in education, not for the return, but to provide better quality education. And there are many companies, many associations that are investing in education to help the education process in Brazil. This is perhaps the most important area in which private sector is helping the government. And what they do, they try to improve the quality of education in a limited number of schools. But the problem is much bigger. And I think there was a frequent change of ministers of education. This was not a good thing. And I know it's a priority, but I can't tell you what exactly is going to be done.
Well, thank you very much. With that, it's time to conclude. It's 12 o'clock. I wanted to thank Ambassador Sergio Amaral very much for his very candid presentation. I hope this is the first of many interactions like this. Having been here for a while in Washington, having seen presentations by Brazilian officials, I became very resistant to presentations that talk about the future in very detailed, especially if it involves a PowerPoint, because I know that that's not going to happen. And so this is the type of dialogue that we have been trying to foster here at the Brazil Institute, at the Wilson Center. I wanted to recognize one person in particular that is in this audience, it's my friend José Luis Machado Costa, Brazilian ambassador to the Organization of American States. I should have done this at the beginning, at the start, but now you know why I'm not a diplomat. So. Thank you very much, Ambassador Anthony Harrington, for helping us host Ambassador Sergio Amaral. Sergio, thank you very much. This is your home in Washington. Thank you very much. A round of applause for the ambassador.
That was terrific.
Did you like it?
Yeah. No.